Thank you for downloading this podcast from the Forum for Philosophy. Subscribe for weekly discussions of science, culture, politics, and the arts from a philosophical perspective. The Forum is a non-profit organization, and our events are free and open to all. You can support our work via our website and Facebook page.
Hello, I'm Shahidha Bari. You can call me Shahidha. I'm one of the fellows of the Forum. I too am recognising faces. It's like seeing friends. So welcome to this Forum event on mood. I hope yours is good and sunny and inquiring today. Mood is that ephemeral thing. It can change with the seasons and it can elude our control. The reason I thought this would be an enlightening or interesting event to run this semester was that I feel like we are living in a very particularly sensitive political mood. I think lots of us might feel like there is a cultural mood that has purchase and that we have been swept up in it. And historically, we've talked about moods of optimism and moods of despair. And it occurred to me that there is a kind of paradox in mood being this thing that can feel like a general temperature of a culture, but also this very deeply personal experience. I mean, who doesn't know the feeling of waking up in the morning and feeling a sense of despair at the headlines? And it's a mood that seems shared by many other people. So in this event, we want to ask, what is a mood? What affects mood? How do we read a mood? How do we measure something like a spirit of an age? And why is our mood, or how is our mood, susceptible to drugs, the media and music, all of those things, or the weather even. So joining us to discuss are Ben Highmore. Ben's the Professor of Cultural Studies at the University of Sussex. His particular interests at the moment cluster around cultural feelings, domestic life, and post-war British art, architecture, and design. His books include Everyday Life and Cultural Theory, and most recently a book on interiors, which is the one I really want to read, so I'm hoping you'll give me a free copy at some point. Carolyn Pedwell is an Associate Professor of Cultural Studies at the University of Kent, although an LSE grad too. She researches the international politics of emotion and affect, and her books include Affective Relations, The Transnational Politics of Empathy, and Feminism, Culture, and Embodied Practice. And Anil Sebastian is a producer, singer, and multi-instrumentalist. He was warming up his voice earlier because he said he's used to performing singing. And then I was like, oh, that's good to know for this event. So maybe you can think of a question that might prompt him. But Anil is the founder director of the London Contemporary Voices Choir. His work has seen him regularly working on arrangements for and appearing alongside the likes of Alt-J, Imogen Heap, Laura Mavula, and U2. I think you might be the coolest person we've ever had on the Forum. Your debut album is called Mesonoxian, and you can purchase it on his website, anilsebastian.com. So I'm going to start with talking to our panellists. We'll talk amongst ourselves, and we will open up to the floor, so do save up your questions. Ben, I want to start with you, because you've been thinking and writing about mood from an academic perspective. What made you think that something like mood could be the subject of a meaningful intellectual inquiry?
Thank you. First, I want to. I just realised that mood is doom backwards. And one of the things I'm kind of really interested in, what kinds of moods get considered, get written about, why are bad moods perhaps more noticeable than flat moods, for instance. But I think it became something that I became interested in, partly because I was very interested in sort of indistinct things. My PhD was on everyday life, and I had to keep saying, oh, you know, this is what I work on, everyday life. And people say, oh my God. So I tried to find something even more intangible than everyday life. And mood was something that I got interested in. And one of the, I guess, one of the kind of key things that prompted me was I started doing some work on mass observation, which is a group of social investigators from the 1930s, and they set themselves up partly to ask questions about who speaks on behalf of mood, of things like a national mood. So they were writing in the wake of Chamberlain coming back from his meeting with Hitler, and the newspapers would say, you know, Britain is on the, you know, has this kind of mood of anticipation as they wait for Neville Chamberlain to come back. And Matt's observation was saying, how do we know? You know, maybe they're just waiting to see what the pools are, the football pools have come up with, or look at their astrology signs. And so that was a kind of, that was my way in, I suppose.
And what did the your work investigating the mass observation tell you? What did you find out about mood from that?
Well, one of the things was that that there were lots of different terms for mood. Especially around the 1930s, and one of the things that, that became part of the book I did on mood was thinking about morale. So morale became the name for producing moods that weren't good moods, but were productive moods. And I thought that was a kind of interesting thing, that moods didn't have to be emotional. Mm-hmm. There can be moods of concentration, of getting on with things, and this was very much during the war, was, you know, the answer to mass bombing is not happiness, kind of glee. In fact, that kind of mood is really kind of critiqued. But you don't want a mood as well that's kind of despairing. You want something that can anticipate it but kind of move on. So that was a kind of interesting aspect. Yeah.
And were they right that the idea that if someone makes a general pronouncement that there is a mood of despair, was that right from the mass observation?
I don't think it's. I've got a kind of two answers to this, which I think are both true. I think there are national moods, and I don't think there are national moods at exactly the same time. I think there are kind of moods that we can say they exist, and they kind of have an actuality to them. They're produced by all sorts of things, maybe newspapers, maybe comedy, maybe memes, and yet people have particular responses to them. They don't necessarily follow those moods, but those moods inform, I think, how we, you know, how we think about now as a kind of generally a sense of deflation, perhaps, or resignation for some people. It's really difficult to kind of find optimism and hope. You'll sort of have to kind of dredge it up by remembering, you know, what's good about the world, or
a national mood and not a national mood ever.
Yeah.
Very helpful answer, Ben. Anil, you're reaching. Did you have a response to that?
I was just thinking about isolated communities, actually, and thinking about how some of those national moods might, how far they might permeate into more isolated communities, and what that might tell us. Yeah, that's one thing I was thinking about, and I was also thinking about. I'm aware of some of your work on habits, and I was thinking about how, when you break something in that daily habit picture, how that affects mood, and whether there are things that kind of, maybe like poke through, from our mass observation, you know, from mass observations that kind of knock some of those things out of place a little bit, and what effect those have.
I was thinking about this the other day, that, you know, when we had that kind of fantastic weather in the middle of February, and both kind of having a sense of, wow, this is great, it's climate change, we're all going to die.
Yeah.
And holding those things almost kind of in suspension together, and how we do that quite a lot.
And I think that's absolutely the case, that 3 days of sunshine makes you think the summer is here and the world is going to be absolutely fine, and then it just takes a cloud or another Brexit vote, something or one or the other. We're not partisan here about those things. Carolyn, did you have a response to Ben?
I was also wondering, because you were talking about mood, morale, all the different words that might describe something to do with mood, and I've been thinking about, like, what's the relationship between mood and atmosphere, for example, because we use them a lot in the same ways, but you wouldn't usually use the word atmosphere to describe something you felt personally. Mm-hmm. You could walk into a room and sense an atmosphere. We've all done that. Maybe you did that tonight when you walked in here. But you wouldn't describe your own mood as an atmosphere. Mm. But at the same time, I don't think it's right to say that mood then is only individual or personal, because the things we're talking about are also collective. I think both atmospheres and moods are relational, so they're about relationships between bodies and environments, widely conceived.
Yeah.
But I'm actually still thinking through what might those relationships be. Yeah.
I'm interested in when we say, even those kind of really personal moods, that we say, I'm in a mood, rather than the mood is in me. You know, that sense that it's kind of emanates and somehow kind of saturates an environment in a way that is connected, I think, to kind of atmosphere. And I mean, I used to teach stuff around mood, and one of the things was just simply dimming the lights. And it really, you know, the chatter goes down, it kind of, expectation happens. It's both atmosphere and a kind of certain kind of mood of attention, concentration.
I do that when a lecture is particularly noisy and I can't get their attention. I'm like this very obedient audience where I'll dim the lights and then the hush descends, of course, and then I start the séance. Caroline, can I move to you, because you're a scholar of mood, but you've also been thinking about the mood of scholarship. So tell me about that.
Yeah, I mean, just to start, I guess we wouldn't necessarily think there's a clear relationship between philosophy and mood necessarily on first glance, but some of the philosophers and scholars of mood, like Rita Felsky and others, would argue that like mood is not a choice in relation to reading a philosophical or other text, that there's always some mood in which you approach it, whether that's kind of curiosity or wonder or boredom or frustration. But then there's also an argument that texts have their own moods, which might be linked to the kind of affective atmospheres in which they were written. So when you're engaging with the text, you're actually, in a way, kind of negotiating between whatever your own mood might be and what your text mood might be and the wider moods or atmospheres in which you're in. One of the things I've been particularly interested in, both as a kind of academic but also a teacher, is there a mood to critique? You know, I guess critique is one of the main methods I use in cultural studies or sociology or politics. It's what we teach our undergraduate students. You've got to write an essay and be critical. Don't just describe, you know, be analytical and critical. Well, what might be the mood of critique, and does that matter? This is a question that the late queer theorist and literary scholar Eve Sedgwick asked, and she associated critique with the propensity to slide into what she called paranoid reading. And this was an idea that critique has become so normative in our field, so expected, that it kind of operates sometimes by, you already know what you're going to find before you find it in a text or a problem, and you just have to search for it and then reveal it. And usually it's going to be a bad thing that you want to criticize. But if that's the case, are you working in a mood of kind of paranoia, vigilance, anxiety, kind of looking for the bad so you can expose it? And in doing so, might you actually prevent your ability to kind of sense and engage with change as it's unfolding? One of the things that Sedgwick thinks about are how might we develop what she calls more reparative reading habits rather than paranoid ones.
Yeah.
People interpret reparative reading in lots of different ways, but one of them might be an orientation of kind of nurturance and love towards your object of investigation or your text, rather than this more paranoid one. What might that open up different to kind of what you might find through the standard mode of critique?
Are you thinking of particular thinkers? Do you have particular thinkers in mind when you imagine that reparative reading?
I guess Eve Sedgwick is the main person who's it's associated with, but I'm also thinking about other writers in kind of studies of emotion and affect. The anthropologist Kathleen Stewart is somebody who I really think about. I don't think she necessarily uses the term reparative reading, but what she's trying to do is think about, actually, what happens if we move back to description and think about its value? What happens if we don't go in with critique as as our starting point, and we try to take everyday situations, moods. She talks about what does it feel like to be part of the mainstream, or how do we understand the lived textures of racism, and what if we try to actually just describe those without moving right away to kind of critique or an analytic perspective. And so if you read her work, you know, she's a professor of anthropology, but it's not the kind of academic work maybe one might usually encounter. And the first time I read her book, Ordinary Affect, I think I kind of thought, okay. And then I read it again a few years later, and it just actually blew me away, and I got so much more out of it, kind of inhabiting this, this kind of, in a sense, loving form of description for the everyday.
Well, I wonder what the implications of this kind of mood-sensitive reading or scholarship is. I mean, what does it look like? Is it that it's not just that we go skipping joyfully into text, but that we're more responsive to a mood that might be there rather than seeking something?
Yeah, I think that's a really good question, because one of the questions I had about reparative reading, you know, as an alternative to so-called paranoid reading, is, well, can you choose that mood?
Yeah.
Like, can you choose the mood you bring towards a particular text? You can't just decide not to be depressed, for example, or not to be in a certain mood. So what if reparation is not the mood you bring? But equally, what if that orientation doesn't make sense to the text that you're reading, or the problem you're engaging with? Another interpretation of reparative reading that I've seen in the cultural studies literatures is less about an orientation of love or a desire to repair, and more about being able to inhabit ambivalence. So not trying to come up with a kind of watertight critique or even a solution or how we're going to move forward, but actually seeing what happens if we sit with the ambivalence and kind of recognition that good and bad are intertwined all the way through, in a way.
And this is a model of reading that's sort of unembarrassed about feeling and affect, of course, as opposed to the quite rigid universalizing instincts of philosophy. It feels like something slightly antithetical to philosophy, or certain parts of philosophy, I guess. I wondered if Ben or Anil had responses to that.
I was thinking, when you were talking, I often think a really useful way of thinking about mood is to say, when you wake up and you've had a dream, it seems like the most important thing about that dream is its mood. You know, you can talk about what happened in it and it doesn't make any sense, but actually the feeling you're left with is kind of really huge. And it does strike me that it's a really, maybe we don't actually know what's happening when we're kind of reading endless critiques of this or that. Foucault and these things. Obviously, they're sensitizing us to the world in particular ways.
I think that's
true. I was thinking, as you were talking about texts that have a mood, I was thinking of reading The Bell Jar when I was about 18 and having a real headache reading it as a result of reading it. But to read it properly, actually, you should have a headache reading The Bell Jar. It is about being in a fug or being and not picking up the feminism or the critique of feminism in the 60s, or it wasn't even about a kind of textual analysis. It was about receiving something and how that was cultivated in that text. I don't know, did you have a text in mind? Were you thinking about?
No, but I kind of thought of something else with what you and Ben were just saying, which is when I think back to what I learned as an undergraduate, I remember very little content. I don't like to think that about my students, but I'm sure it'll be the same. I remember very little content. What you do remember and stays with you and you don't realize until you have to use it or much later is ways of thinking, approaches of thinking, but I think, as you say, also ways of sensing and kind of sensibilities. And, I was talking with Ben a couple months ago about inculcating we're trying to develop a more intuitive mode of engaging with scholarship. But I think for undergraduate students, it also has its risks too. Would we want just all of our students to only engage intuitively? And what would that mean? So,
And in philosophy, it would take a very particular turn, I think. I mean, I'm just imagining reading Rousseau lately, reading Reveries of a Solitary Walker, when he gets hit by the Great Dane running at him, which always makes me laugh, and it's terrible to laugh. He takes a terrible tumble, and his lip falls apart, and it's awful, but it's quite comic too. But to actually, you get the sense of the world tilting, because when that happens, he starts to think about the world differently, and that text really comes up upon you. And there's a way of reading Rousseau as a philosopher, and perhaps as a way of feeling Rousseau's mood, which that text conveys too. Yeah, although, I mean, I'm not sure how some more boring philosophers would get on. Anna, can I move to you? So I want you to sing at any opportune moment. what's been your experience as a musician thinking about how moods can be cultivated or manufactured?
Well, thank you. So I will maybe sing at some point. We'll see what happens with that. I think the first thing that comes to mind is how, as composers, we have perhaps a kind of like clusters of techniques or clusters of kind of moods, feelings, emotions, which relate to these sort of map onto these kind of compositional techniques that create an overall mood in a piece of music. What's interesting about that to me at the moment is how we've moved from, if you think about music for film, we've had films, but we now have series. So this sort of time stretching of a narrative over, you know, however many hours of, you know, 30, 40 hours of, and that's, you know, how do you compose for an entire series? But then we also have the opposite going on at the same time in our culture. We also have Instagram, and we have these like tiny 15-second moments. And I found in my work as a composer that one week I'm trying to create an hour and a half long piece of music, and the next minute I'm trying to create something that's 10 seconds long, like this tiny little ident thing. It's like, oh God, you know. And how those how that kind of contraction and expanse. Sorry, I did that the wrong way around. Yeah, and I think the other thing that's interesting about that is that I think we develop an immunity very quickly. Yeah. So, you know, if you're watching a whole series and the composer is just using the same old tricks for the heart-jerking moment, and you're supposed to feel, like, sad, you're supposed to, you know, connect with a bigger mood, you can't just keep doing the same thing. So as composers, we're having to kind of find ways to get the same mood but swap something out or disrupt it or change it. But at the same time, I think there are some fundamental things that are very primal within us. The human voice is one of them. We respond automatically. It takes priority in a mix of music. You can have it the quietest thing in the mix and people will tune into that, and especially if there are lyrics involved. That's where your mind goes. But there are some other things as well. Bass, for example, low frequencies, they have a really profound effect on us, and animals as well. Apparently at London Zoo, in London Zoo Late, you're not allowed to play bass below a certain frequency because it freaks the cats out. They don't mind anything else. So if you're stuck in the jungle and you're meet a lion, you know, turn up your drum and bass. Well, I don't know. What does it do to human beings? I think low sounds, very deep sounds, I think they're akin to sort of thunder. And it kind of gives you a sense of, oh, danger, and something's happening. And it's something of great power. I mean, maybe like a giant walking kind of thing. But then I think what I wanted to sort of come on to was how modern production techniques within music can really mess up what happens in nature. So one of the things that happens in nature, when I sing, I have to breathe in. You know, and if I hit a drum, I have to lift my hand. So there is always this counter motion going on. In editing, you can clip that out. I can take out all the breaths. So you just suddenly are straight into the sound. And it's extremely unexpected. So that's one thing, editing. The other thing is kind of, there's a kind of hallucination called Lilliput sight, where, you know, it's a hallucination of scale where things appear suddenly very large or very small. And I think in sound you could have something perhaps called Lilliput sound. I just made that up. where you can play with scale. So one of the things that you'll hear in the piece of music that I'm going to play a few bits. One thing I like to do is with vocals, for example, I could place my vocal so it feels as if it's right in your ear. So I'm whispering in the singing, but I've made that whisper loud over an entire orchestral arrangement. It's completely unnatural. There's no way that we could recreate that in this room unless, you know, we did something really crazy, like make the orchestral musicians really far away. So it's this thing of being able to put something suddenly right in front of you. So that's one thing. And then I think anything that warps this kind of natural dynamic between intimacy and expanse, so that is one of those things as well. So perhaps if we play a piece of music, before we play it, I should say that this piece of music is called Lydian. I co-wrote it with a composer called Guy Sigsworth, who's produced music for all sorts of amazing people. He's done the production on this track, and I've done the vocals. He's one of my biggest influences, but I can't take any credit for the production, but I'm going to talk about it. So we'll play a bit of it.
Not conscious of anything.
Yes, so the techniques here, so one thing is tempo in this track. So the opening sound there is a celesta. Guy Sigsworth is an expert on Baroque music. He plays the harpsichord, he played with the European Baroque Orchestra and then became a pop music producer, which, you know, as you do. There's a tempo wave that's going on that's kind of super impossible to do in real life. So it's kind of drawing a tempo map. So the tempo of that celesta is artificially created, creating this kind of supernatural kind of thing that's not really possible to do in person. So that's one thing. The celesta is really close. It's like you can hear all the mechanism sounds, and you know, that's something that people have been afraid of in the past. You know, mechanism sound is something that you get rid of. You remove mechanism. Yeah. And then, and you would have heard that the vocal is like super soft but really loud in the mix. So
was I supposed to feel sleepy?
Yeah. I mean, it's modelled on sea waves as well. Yeah. So the bass particularly, there's one bass that goes, and while it's doing that, there's another one coming up against it, so that you have this kind of counter motion, a diving and a rising going the other way. Yeah.
Are there particular, if we wanted to cheer ourselves up, what would you play to us? What would you
need that I have? Oh, no.
Well, tell me about any of the
selections. Actually, that reminds me of something else. So I was in LA recently writing some songs with someone called Dan Kroll, and we were writing for a film. But there was something that he told me, and I don't know if this is true, it might not be true, but apparently there's a Justin Bieber song where the producer buried the sound of an alarm clock just before the chorus. It's not something that you would perceive, you know, you'd really have to listen out for it to know it was there, but the theory is that this was put in the track so that you have this moment just before the chorus where you think you're being woken up for the chorus. That, I don't know why that reminded me of that, but that came into my head.
Do you want to play something else for us?
I could play music endlessly, but
let's
hear
one more thing,
Sure, okay, what shall we play? I could play something, actually that's a bit similar, so maybe I'll play, okay, this is quite strange, I hate the saxophone, it's one of the most hated instruments, for me it evokes kind of 1980s sort of, you know, terribleness.
Baker Street,
exactly. So I decided to do something different with it to create a different mood. And what I've done, there's a saxophone choir. I don't know if that exists as a term, but I just, why not? A stack of saxophones, and then immediately afterwards, I've just taken the mechanism sound. So I've actually done the opposite. I've edited out all the note, and I've just got the sound of the keys clicking, and just the breath, just the intakes of sound, and I've constructed a piece of music out of that, which I'm curious to know what mood that creates. It's with an Icelandic artist called...
one to call. But that makes me think there's something in sort of the mechanism of this, the mood of a saxophone, which might be kind of loungy or 80s Baker Street.
Yeah.
But the mechanical work that goes into making that is quite different, isn't it?
Yeah.
And that makes me think about how we manufacture mood. And is there a difference between a mood that is manufactured and a mood that springs naturally in us?
I think yes and no at the same time again. I think that there are these, I keep going back to, in music, keep thinking of, you know, the human voice being this very primal thing, and that, you know, in a way that's connected, so something like that will, hearing the sound of singing will instantly pull you in and create a mood that you just react to very instinctively.
Yeah.
But then I think, I guess there's more like an outer circle of more complex things that relate to where we are and that relate to how, you know, maybe a national mood or a international mood, or, you know. Yeah.
Well, I thought that was, I mean, if you hadn't said there was Icelandicness going on,
yeah,
I'd have got the Icelandic.
Yeah, that's funny, isn't it?
But that is a question, isn't it? If I'm listening to Icelandic music and I get a mood of introspection, is that because I'm listening to it as a non-Icelander?
Yeah, I think that's a really interesting point. I mean, Iceland's an amazing place, and I seem to spend a lot of time working with Icelandic artists, creating the sound of Iceland, despite having nothing to do with Iceland. And I think one of the interesting things there is this playing with scale and taking the very small and magnifying it to the very large. And I don't know if that's connected with the landscape, and whether the landscapes that we exist, that we live in, also affect our mood. I'm sure they do. And of course, you've got things like the time of year and the weather, and you know how the light affects things.
What do you think? Well, Ben and Carolyn, being our mood experts, is the evidence that mood is culturally specific? That we're attuned to the mood of our particular peoples, or?
When you were both speaking now. I was actually thinking about the kind of political theorist Benedict Anderson, who talks about nationalism and what is nationalism and how do we get the sense of being in a nation, because it doesn't necessarily exist just naturally or authentically. It has to be mediated in all sorts of different ways. So you know, he talks about kind of national televised events, like in the UK, it could be Wimbledon or you know, the World Cup or whatever, that actually are necessary to kind of create a feeling of what it means to be British, or in my case Canadian, or whatever, which really is about mood too. So I mean, I guess there's questions to ask about what is natural and how we understand authenticity. I mean, our mood's always mediated in some way. And then thinking about what Anil was saying about the work he's doing to create a sense of Iceland through these kind of musical techniques is really interesting.
Yeah. Ben?
Maybe that's why we go on holiday, to try and find different moods.
Yeah.
You know, there's
a certain
kind of damp mood in Britain a lot of the time, and we go elsewhere to hear different sounds, smells. I mean, it's a very material thing, I think, a lot of the time, mood. To do perhaps with the weather and a whole range of kind of cultural things. Language. Yeah. I remember hearing a translator saying that she was an English to Italian translator, and she said that she was really kind of shy and repressed most of the time, but then she'd go to Italy and start having arguments with people kind of immediately and kind of you know, expressing herself. And there is that sense, isn't there, that, you know, how would you could inhabit a different kind of being in the world, a different way of kind of feeling the world in different kind of places with different language.
Yeah.
Different.
My husband says, I'm not angry, I'm just Scottish. The accent just makes him sound really furious. But that makes me think that what alters our mood? What's the one factor that has the most power to alter or shape our mood, do you think?
I don't know if this is the one factor, but I've been thinking a lot about how we're governed partially through mood, kind of in a political way. And I mean, one thing I'm thinking about is the modes of governance employed, especially in the United States, but also here, right after the events of September 9/11 and the kind of months that ensued. And Brian Massumi has written about governing through fear. And if you recall, we had those, you know, the amber, red, the kind of alerts of kind of how much danger what was the threat level? And kind of they seemed to always be somewhere between the highest, you know, and kept going back and forward. And you kind of, but you, of course, were never told what exactly constituted that threat. But of course, that is a mode of governing. If you keep a population in a constant state of fear or anxiety, at least for a limited amount of time, that might allow you to get them to do certain things. And so, you know, I have, like all of us, been thinking about Brexit and what ways we might be governed through moods, as it seems to be a process with no end. And yeah, so I think, you know, there's things that are going on with us personally and interpersonal reactions and kind of forms of media and music, but there's also kind of ways that we're being governed, you know, at the level of the state and how that infiltrates into everyday life.
Yeah. I want to come back to that really important question in a moment, but just to get the poll in, what most affects our mood from Anil and Ben?
Well, I was in a care home for people with advanced dementia recently, and one of the most amazing things that happened was I was there when the royal wedding happened. For some context, I was working with people with advanced dementia to create poetry with their words and to eventually then create music. And I was there for 11 weeks. It was a really amazing residency with Living Words, a charity that I was working with. And when the royal wedding came on, it was really interesting because all the usual cues in the music, the kind of presentation, the grandeur of it, had almost the opposite of the intended effect. Because I imagine some people would have been there thinking, am I supposed to know what's happening? I can see this is a royal wedding, maybe. Some people felt that they were in the room. Mm-hmm. People commented on the smell in the church. People commented on the temperature, and which I found absolutely incredible. People commented on the music as though the singer was right in front of them, you know, saying things like, I really got a good view. I could really see the expression on his face. Some people panicked because they didn't know anyone in the church. I didn't know anyone in the church. I didn't know where I was. So this sense of dislocation from the national kind of mood was really fascinating to me. Mm-hmm. speaking with them afterwards, how it kind of almost, they all started in the same place in the living room watching the same thing. Some people went to their rooms to put their finest clothes on, some people burst into tears, and it just, everybody kind of went in different directions and then found themselves back again, and it was fascinating.
But it sounds like the content of the, I think we were all supposed to think it was a mood of national jubilant creation, yes, wasn't it? Yeah. Meghan Markle and Prince Harry's wedding. But the content of the mood didn't matter, that it was the intensity that they were registering, and either at distress, the level of distress, or the level of involvement, perhaps.
Yeah.
The intensity. What about you, Ben? What most affects mood?
Well, I was just to sort of, I suppose, kind of have a slightly different aspect of that kind of government thing, which was, I mean, I grew up in the 70s, where we were, you know, nuclear war was about to happen constantly. But actually, that anxiety is not something you can sustain, that kind of mood of anxiety. So that kind of comes in and out of focus, I think. And maybe there are other things that are more, I mean, maybe what we need is kind of sense of different durations of mood. You know, there's a kind of sustained moods, and then sudden bursts of mood. Humour is a big burst of mood. I went to see that film called The Clock, which is 24 hours made up of people looking at clocks. And it's just a mood of endless kind of anticipation, of kind of like, you know, am I going to get there on time? Is the bomb going to go off? When are they arriving? It's like, oh my God, it's so good.
Well, our podcast has usually said that Ben has just enacted all of those movies. Yeah, I can see how the Christian Markle might make you feel quite agitated. But so let's maybe hit that question about governance and political mood head on, which Carolyn has raised, because, you know, some people would say this is, we call ourselves humans of late capitalism, don't we? That's the kind of slightly flippant way to talk about our culture at the moment. But is there a mood that capitalism cultivates? But is there a dominant mood that we're in that is a product of our political age?
I was actually asking my students this question in the seminar the other day, and now I'm trying to remember what they said.
Good answers. Sure, they were right.
I mean, they were saying, one of the things they said is kind of a mood of capitalism or an atmosphere is kind of always feeling, is a comparative one, that you're always comparing yourselves with others and the kind of...
Fear of missing out.
Fear of missing out. And also maybe the kind of, we think about the older work on advertising and consumption and marketing and mood. Of course, one of the key strategies is to create a constant feeling of lack or not being good enough. And that is something kind of they were certainly talking about. But they were also talking about austerity. And they were talking about what it means to kind of be a young person, kind of, you know, because of the financial crisis with 2008, like, I mean, that's 10 years ago. Some of them were 8 years old. So it's been a long part of their life where they have this sense, this mood, but also told that we're in a pretty bad financial situation and that their opportunities aren't there and stuff. So, you know, it made me think of some of the really interesting work that's been published recently on how austerity, the effects of austerity are of course seen in lots of different ways, the worst of one of them being death, but also through mood, through kind of things that people might think are just personal or their fault or their failing, if it's kind of depression or a feeling of hopelessness, but actually that could be an effect of capitalism, to put it bluntly, or the ways that we're governing kind of the crisis, ongoing crises of capitalism. There's a great image I use in my teaching that was distributed in New York City around May Day, kind of a few years back, and it's a poster that says, depressed, it might be capitalism, and then it kind of links all these different symptoms of kind of capitalism, which is interesting for the students then to think about, okay, how are what I think of as my most personal, even secret feelings, moods, and emotions also part of a much wider cultural, social, but also economic sphere, and they're never just my own.
Yeah.
And do you think mood could be generational then? I mean, you're talking about kind of
certain generation of people who've kind of grown up in the aftermath of
disasters. Yeah, I know we're supposed to think critically about the concept of generation, but I actually, I mean, it really resonates with me when I think about my grandparents' generation and kind of, the kind of idea of being in the 1930s and thinking about kind of the Depression and the idea of always having to kind of save and anxiety of what happens if you don't do that properly, and which seems quite different to my parents' generation, in some ways.
It reminds me of an article I read recently about millennial burnout. And I think perhaps one thing at the moment with mood, relating to what I said earlier about music, is this contraction and expansion of time and an expectation to be both here in the moment all the time, right here and now, sharing, liking, being quite kind of open in some sense. But then at the same time having this huge, expansive arc of the narrative of your life as well, you know, your career, your job, and how you frame yourself, and how those things interlock. And, you know, one day of not posting on your Instagram stories and how that kind of affects your mood and how you have these, you know.
Well, that's a new version of the, you know, if the a tree falls in a wood. If you don't express your mood on social media, does it exist? Do you have a mood?
Yeah, and I think there is that. I do think there's this kind of, you know, like kind of almost like a negative space. So there's a way that a void, you know.
I mean, we haven't talked about lack of mood, a kind of a mood or a
absence,
disaffection or disaffection is a mood.
Moodlessness.
Yeah, is that such a thing?
Not for Heidegger. Heidegger. Have to get Heidegger
it's
in.
It's taken 45 minutes for us to get Heidegger in. It's pretty much a good record for us.
You know, a lack of mood is not an absence of mood, it's just a particular form of mood. And I think that's, you know, there are kind of things on there that you go into a library and it doesn't necessarily have a mood, but actually it's that lack of mood that's a kind of crucial element to it.
It reminds me a little bit of when we were upstairs, we were talking about static sounds and how in this room, the static sound is mainly the projector and a few other things, our breathing. But there is, it's almost like there's this, in every room, in every space we're in, there is this kind of underlying sound bed. And in a way, when you remove some of that, some of the other sounds that are there, you have this kind of underlying, what is the underlying kind of mood? What's the kind of, is there such a thing?
The kind of drone mood.
The drone, the kind of, the thing that's constant. And when you switch that off, what happens? You know, if you know.
Well, I guess previous social theorists would have talked about ennui, anime, those kind of, kind of pervasive moods that might try and name a condition or something. Perhaps we talk about boredom in the same way.
Was thinking about boredom. And I was thinking when you were talking about digital media, there's a lot of work that's coming out now about boredom, linking it to digital culture. Like on the one hand, this idea that we feel we should always be active and kind of doing things, so then when we don't have that stimulation, like you don't have your phone on the plane or something, that you're bored. But also I really like Jody Dean's work, The Media Theorist, where she kind of talks about why do we kind of get addicted or stuck to technology? Why do we get in those loops where we're scrolling on Twitter and then on our phone on something else and, you know, you can't get out of them, and next thing you know, 3 hours have passed and you haven't got anything done. She says one of the reasons that happens is because we're constantly searching for these little nuggets of affective kind of stimulation, right? Like a little jolt, something to satisfy us. And we find them, we get these little jolts, but they're never satisfying enough. And that we're constantly failing to kind of find satisfaction online. But she's kind of used Lacan's kind of psychoanalytic work to say we enjoy something about that failure. So something about that continual search for jolts of satisfaction that we find, but they're never good enough, is what keeps us stuck in these loops. Now, of course, for her, the point is that when we're doing that and we think we're just frittering away time, which we are, we're also providing the data and the labor that fuels communicative capitalism, as she calls it. So in fact, we're working for major corporations like Facebook and whatever. Yeah. And we're doing it for free. Because we're not getting paid for it.
Well, now you mentioned Facebook, the enemy. I want to ask you about suspicion. I mean, and not to lapse into the paranoid reading that you were signalling, Carolyn. I'm much more seduced by your restorative, reparative reading. But should we be suspicious of who's seeking to alter our moods? And I mean, not just governments and Facebook corporations, but pharmaceutical companies. Should we be suspicious of who's seeking to alter our mood?
I'm
musicians too.
Musicians, but I was thinking of Justin Bieber and the alarm clock, you know, that sneaky things there. I was actually thinking about how this might change in the future with artificial intelligence and neural implants,
yeah.
And how those things might influence the direction that goes in, and particularly in terms of when some people have them and some people don't.
Well, I guess there's a kind of mood hygiene thing going on, isn't there? You know, what moods are good for you? What moods are productive? Oh, you don't want to go down that mood because that's it's a kind of cul-de-sac. And that's kind of interesting in terms of that kind of endless productivity that we're kind of all kind of being asked to be. You know, what moods are going to be going to fulfill this kind of productive need. And I suppose there's a kind of interesting thing about contemplative moods or moods that don't really go anywhere or... You know, maybe there are kind of interesting moods that aren't particularly on our horizon at the moment that we need to think more about.
I was thinking also what Anil was saying about artificial intelligence. I mean, I guess one of the things that is happening now with artificial intelligence is kind of that they're becoming more and more human, whatever that means. So one thing that means is the ability for machines to learn human habits and forms of emotional expression. But then once they've learned that, to actually build on it themselves. So there's kind of also interesting questions of what constitutes, like, is mood a human thing? So we don't necessarily think of animals having moods, but maybe we could think of a moody cat or...
I was just thinking of my cat.
What does it mean to think about...
Yeah.
Machines or artificial intelligence having moods of their own that are actually outside of human control with kind of adaptive algorithmic architectures. You know, you hear those stories about the two kind of bots that had to be disabled by scientists because they develop a language of their own that they didn't understand anymore and they didn't know what was going to happen. So I'm kind of wondering, you know...
It's our new Turing test, isn't it?
It is.
A robot feels a mood. Let's turn out to the floor for some questions.
I'm not convinced when you're talking about moods of populations, of nations or crowds or people in this room, it's the same thing as talking about an individual's mood. Mm-hmm. And in fact, I think ultimately it's only in individuals that you get the mood. So you talk about the mood of this room and the sounds in it, but it has no mood until I enter it. And my response to the room creates my mood, and that is the mood that I perceive, which may be the same as the one that you perceive, but it may be different. Mm-hmm. Now, in the fact that you are perceiving something, and I perceive you perceiving it, then we perhaps get a collective mood, which may be generated out of the individual moods, but it's really actually coming out of an individual thing. And I think animals, actually plants have moods. You know, if you drop your leaves in the winter, you're sort of suggesting something about your perception of the world around you, what you can do about it. And I think in the case of animals, it's caution versus risk-taking. So I think the moods that we have as individuals are ways of our minds integrating a response to something outside us. And it's actually quite difficult to simultaneously have two different moods operating at the same time. If you do have that, you suspect your sanity. So it's actually a way of integrating our response to the world and to other people. Sometimes other people, but what's going on around us. So I think ultimately mood is an individual thing, but it can have collective consequences, if you like, which are not the same as mood.
There's a couple of observations there, but perhaps we can try and respond to that first one about how a collective mood is perhaps generated from a singular experience of mood. What do you think of that idea?
Well, I would agree with you, because I think one of the points that comes from what you're saying is that, like, mood is never static. Like, mood can't be frozen or kind of bottled. It's dynamic. It's always changing. And kind of as people in this room, we all have a slightly different interpretation of mood, and then we give off something that then in turn contributes to changing it. So I agree with you that if we're going to talk about, or what I interpret from your saying is that we're going to talk about mood, we have to talk about it as constantly moving, evolving, and kind of not singular, as involving diversities. But in terms of mood being an individual thing, like for me, what mood does in a sense is disrupt the idea of kind of the bounded individual, because the fact that moods can get in us, as you say, or that we can kind of then contribute to collective moods makes us, kind of opens up the idea of the individual, makes it a lot more permeable, like, you know, the kind of boundaries we might assume that individuals have kind of become blurred. So I guess I think about moods not necessarily as collective or individual, but relational, which I think is kind of what you're saying in a way.
It kind of made me think of transitional spaces in a way. So I was thinking about group singing when you said what you said when you asked your question. And I was thinking of the experience of that when a whole room of people in our choir, I run a choir called London Contemporary Voices, and when we all sing together, you can kind of move through different spaces where each person is responding it very subtly to create an overall shape and mood, and it takes a journey in a direction. And the thing I liken that to is a bit like a murmuration of starlings, where really actually the parameters of each individual bird are quite small, I believe, like just, you know, one direction, however that works, and then you get these incredible overall patterns and motions that appear very complex, maybe. Yeah, that's one thing. And how we enter the transitional spaces that those... How do we create a kind of a possibility of entering a transitional space like that as a group of people?
I sort of both agree and disagree with you. I mean, I sort of, you know, on one level, you can have particular moods that are very, very kind of definite and very difficult to kind of shake off. There's a phrase going around people with teenagers called mood hoovers. And it's when, you're having quite a good time and then your teenager comes home and they hoovered up the mood. Any kind of good mood there's there. It's like sucked out the... But I suppose for me, mood was a way of thinking kind of beyond emotion. And maybe for some people mood would be the wrong word, but for me it was a kind of useful word. For getting beyond that very particular sense of emotion and of affect. And a way of thinking, I guess, about more material, more conventional things. You know, how, for instance, does a religion produce certain kinds of moods in a kind of sustainable and fairly durable way? How do we have that sense of kind of gleeful anticipation at the beginning of a concert or a beginning of a theatre thing? You know, it's all these kind of things, isn't it? It's the lighting, it's the curtains, it's the way into the theatre, it's a whole range of things.
But as an individual, you're modelling what you're perceiving around you, and that's creating the mood within you. But the things around you don't have the mood, do they? But if they're the animals, the creatures, they might do. Can I model them as part of your environment?
Can I ask you about the... Thank you so much, such a good question. But it's just made me think that the material stuff that I think about, the colour green is supposedly the easiest colour to rest on our eyes. It inculcates a certain mood, not an emotion, it's a mood. And you've been talking about material things, but perhaps the gentleman was getting at the mechanics that are not just material but chemical. You know, how is it that that moods are contagious? Is it pheromone? I mean, Carolyn, you said earlier mood can't be bottled, but
maybe,
can't it be bottled?
Yeah.
And it seems to me perhaps it can be bottled.
I think it can be bottled, but even if it is, I'm going to experience that slightly different than you are, or whatever. You know, we have very different effects. We have very different effects from the same drug, whatever. So I think there always is a kind of interaction. Yeah, but Teresa Brennan was someone who talked a lot about contagion and kind of how are moods contagious. She was quite interesting. She was bringing together kind of psychoanalysis, but also neuroscience and writing about pheromones and kind of really giving it quite a material thing. So I think it's, you know, it's these forms of mediation, but there's also obviously something very physical there, and it's about senses and kind of combinations of different senses.
Yeah. Should we get the other question in?
Thank you very much. That was a very insightful talk. I was interested probably more on looking at mood as emotion and how much value you place on the experiencing a full spectrum of moods and emotions and whether, because mood is so fluid as a concept, how important it is to, for example, go through a very depressive mood, which might actually inspire you and stimulate some creativity in a song, or if you go through a very happy mood, for example, like a national mood, and then that kind of continues. For example, the Olympics, there was a very distinct mood in the atmosphere at that time. So I was just interested in that question.
Yeah, I think so. I think if you were, you know, well, I can't imagine anything worse than living with me if I was kind of gleeful all the time. You know? there are kind of moods that you want. You do want that kind of full orchestration, I think.
I'm sure everybody can think of situations that they were in, whether that was kind of clinical depression or just a really hard time or something that was so stressful that you didn't... And at the time, you just wanted to do whatever you could for it to be over or to get out of it or at least to manage it. And, you know, I think about situations like that in my life. But the thing is that having been through, in my case, it was like years of insomnia kind of that kept coming back. It's like, I can get through anything now, it feels like, at least, because I can teach a class on, you know, without having slept for 3 days if I should be required to do so. So I think, I mean, I get that from what you're saying, too, is kind of even our worst moods or kind of, you know, the most bottom kind of point of where you could be. Because I guess suffering is something to the point, because how we experience it, we feel that we are suffering and that's why it's suffering. But then those experiences can kind of sometimes give you some other kind of ability to kind of engage with things later on.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. I was thinking about personal identity while you were talking about what you were talking about. Think about Parfit and what he says about personal identity and you know, are we just one person or are we many people at once, and how does our, you know, personal identity change over time, and how does that relate to mood? And also, do we just have one mood? You know, I mean, we understand the idea of, like, you know, we all have many emotions. Most people would agree that you don't feel one feeling at a time, or, you know, if you're watching a film, you're not kind of just feeling sad because of what's happening on the screen. You're also have many other feelings about many other things, discomfort maybe, and all sorts of other things. So yeah, I guess those are the two thoughts.
That feeling of enjoying, kind of thinking, oh, I'm sad, I'm crying.
Yeah.
That's great. I'm an emotional person.
Yes, exactly. Brilliant.
Or, you know, the world is going to hell in a handcup, but this chocolate cake is so delicious.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, the company is so great. Yes, and that was sort of the tail end of your reflection, the simultaneity of moods too. Can we get another question in, or a couple more questions?
To make a question... I studied moods also, and with this discussion, I was thinking if there is a mood for studying mood. Like, maybe we are looking for mood too much now in this, maybe the generation, but I think this is our time. And maybe this is because of, we are looking for mood, we are looking to mood now. Maybe I just want to discuss that.
So is there a mood for studying mood, and are we looking too hard for moods? Yeah, that's a good question. Two questions.
I think it's that thing of what strikes me is when you focus on something, suddenly how that, you know, that sort of focusing on something, how that changes your context and your relation to it. So, you know, within music, you can plant things within a piece of music on different levels within a song, and some of the songs I do have got hundreds of layers, maybe 180 different individual components, and you can bring something to the foreground and then almost track how your attention follows it as you sink it back down into the abyss of the rest of the track. So I think that idea of when you focus on the idea of mood, how that then how it's almost more the journey that I'm interested in. Of when you're doing that, how it affects you and your relation to the world as it then sinks and rises. Your focus, that is.
Mm-hmm. You two are the mood scholars. What was there a mood you were in when you were studying mood? Were you in a funk?
I suppose there's always, you know, one of the useful things is to always ask yourself, you know, why are you thinking about mood, or why are you thinking about everyday life? Why are you thinking about these sorts of things? You know, is it how are you being determined by things? And it strikes me that mood is, you know, if you'd kind of imagine this maybe at a different point in history, it might seem, you know, slightly kind of overly luxurious to think about mood, where there may be a lot of other things going on. I mean, I do think we spend a lot of time trying to manufacture moods, trying to get the right moods, you know, having our playlists to have a kind of mood. I think, you know, where we getting the dimmer quite right, so our house has a kind of mood that protects us kind of maybe effectually more than anything. But there's also might be a way of thinking, well, you know, how is the world at this moment that it kind of might demand something like a mood analysis or that might be an appropriate response to looking at how it works. I mean, I think, you know, sometimes when I see my mum who reads the Daily Telegraph, you know, I kind of read it because I'm there, and I get a kind of mood of I'm never going out again. The world is full of vicious horror. And you're thinking, wow, this is a really interesting thing here going on, kind of producing these moods, but they're kind of moods of holding you back, I think, from being open to the world in some way. And maybe there are things around mood that are about kind of openness and closeness and kind of how we're sensitized to the world that they're interesting at the moment.
I was thinking in relation to your question about kind of fashions or turns or moods in academic scholarship, because in the 1990s, at least in kind of my field in humanities and social sciences, we were obsessed with language and discourse and text, and then somehow kind of the turn to affect gained force around the kind of, I don't know, early 2000s or mid 2000s, and then everybody started studying emotion and feeling and mood. And now, is that because there were empirical reasons that affect and mood became more important? I mean, in some ways I think there are, or became more resonant, but in other ways it's a kind of trend or a fashion. So kind of all the PhD students now want to apply to study affect rather than discourse. You know, and I actually had to teach, when I first started at University of Kent, they gave me first year classical sociological theory to teach, and I was like, oh gosh. But I reread Marx, Faber, and Durkheim, having probably not read them since the late 1990s, through this lens of mood I had and affect, and it was fascinating because I realized, well, at least because I was looking for it, seemed like that's all they were talking about in a way, especially Durkheim with collective effervescence and kind of, but Marx with kind of talking about a revolutionary spirit and mood. So, yeah, I guess it's also interesting to think if you take the mood now and then look backwards, what do you open up that you didn't see before? This can be interesting.
I think that kind of, you know, we mentioned earlier things like intuition and, you know, if you'd said that in the 80s, I'm kind of, I'm going to look intuitively at this, or something. You'd be kind of laughed out of the...
I still am in my department, just...
there was a question at the back there, and there's some at the front too.
Thank you. The distinction that was made between a reparative or restorative sort of a reading and a more paranoid type one, reminds me of something I've heard in respect of approaching a kind of study of inquiry. So on the one hand, you can look at learning about something, and on the other hand, you can look at learning from, you know, so the latter would seem to have a more kind of potentially at least transformative effect. And maybe a related thought is the potential danger of destroying that which we're trying to understand.
Yeah. Absolutely. I think that's, I mean, the person I was talking about with Eve Sedgwick, who kind of first made that distinction between paranoid and reparative reading, I think that's very resonant with what she was saying, because there's, and I guess it's important to say that she wasn't saying we should do away with paranoid reading or critique. She's saying we need that, but because it's so expected, we've kind of marginalized other ways of reading, of learning from, as you say. So we actually need a broader range of ways of approaching our study, not kind of just one that's the main one. But one of the ways she talked about reparative reading was more in terms of the ability to be surprised. Mm. Like with critique, we're often not surprised because if we know what we want to find and we find it and then we expose it, there's not much room for kind of being surprised or for wonder. Whereas you have a slightly different kind of approach to learning from, as you say, or I guess I think in terms of inhabiting ambivalence, that could lead to other kinds of things, of something that works through finding out things you didn't know before, or kind of not just repeating what you think you already know. So, yeah.
I think also you get that with kind of ideas about kind of ethnography. That kind of idea of kind of collecting people's thoughts and then telling them what they really thought by your kind of superior knowledge. And I kind of, you know, I always worry that universities can teach a certain kind of arrogance about I now know how shit this is, or rather than this kind of sense of modesty, which might actually be a more useful thing to learn.
It's an empathetic thing as well, isn't it, to read in the spirit of the way that something was written, rather than to read with intent or to with distortion in mind. There were two more questions at the front. One question here.
In the context, it's a form of philosophy and that relates to thinking, not relates to critique in eighties and nineties. We haven't heard the word think, but presumably a mood is a rationale to a mood which may be discoverable or not discoverable. That causes a particular emotional effect. So thinking has a place in analysing this mood. I think you referred to it earlier. So you can liberate yourself from a mood and perhaps induce another mood or another state or frame of mind. So the current concern, if that perspective is lost, one is sort of immersed in it, with seemingly no way out of it, or the individual isn't able, hasn't got that resource, or that resource isn't sort of socially affirmed. So this could be somewhat perilous. One could then be collectively manipulable from the outside, through music, for example, through symbols, through linking to associations. So people are, people are divested of thinking, they don't have that armament actually as a form of sort of protection and liberation. I don't know.
Yeah, so this is about a resistance to certain kinds of dominant moods, perhaps, but we also need a resistance. Resistance to the Daily Telegraph or the Guardian, or whatever you're reading. Mm. We talk about bubbles often, don't we? That we need some resistance to a dominant mood. What do you think?
It makes me think of live concerts and live performance and how those are set up. So you walk in and you know, is it seated, is it standing, what's the lighting, what are the smells, does it smell of sticky beer, is it kind of, you know, have we the smell of peppermint in the room for some reason? And I think that, can we resist the way that it's set up? So can you resist feeling elated when the pyrotechnics go off at the final chorus? Can you resist feeling a little bit giddy when the glitter falls, or can you resist, you know, the framing of the concert? Even if you take the music out of it, you know, even if you, you know, even if you take the actual kind of content of what the music is doing, can you resist the framework of what you've been placed into, what you've walked into? That's what that makes me think of.
And your business is lowering our defences so that we can't.
Yes, exactly. And there are certain things that you can do that make that very difficult in music, particularly in live performance, where you can almost guarantee if you play Bohemian Rhapsody at the end of a concert, no matter what the audience is, it seems to somehow work. Even if you've had a contemporary classical music program of Stockhausen or something like that.
Resistance, Carolyn.
Well, your question is one I've been thinking about a lot, really. But I guess like one of the things I come back to is there any thought outside of feeling?
Mm.
Like, actually, if we think about feeling and thought as kind of inseparably intertwined, what actually does kind of rational thought or thought that's somehow able to be outside mean? This might not seem directly related, but one of the scenes I've been thinking about this in is in this environment that we're told now is called post-truth politics and the age of fake news and kind of Trumpism. And for those that are not happy with Trumpism, a lot of what's the strategy that's trying to kind of invoke rational and accuracy-based and truth-based methods of thinking, have been about fact-checking. So the Washington Post newspapers, since before he was elected, had this kind of fact-checker where it's kind of has about 13 different categories of lies or untruths that Trump is implicated in and kind of fact-checks them. And there's lots of other strategies to kind of, point out all the different things he said that's not true from that kind of rational thought. But it doesn't really seem to have any effect with those who support him. And I mean, the geographer Ben Anderson talks about this, and he says one of the reasons that kind of rationale, fact-checking-based approach might not be successful is that Trump's supporters, like, Trump's authority never rested on fact in the first place. It rested on an unwavering affective performance of confidence in himself, of never apologizing, of never saying he was wrong, that somehow appealed in some ways to a large section of his supporters. So if your authority never rested in the first place on that type of truth-based rationality, then maybe the strategies that are being used to try to counter it aren't the only or most effective ones, because somehow Trump and the machine behind him has managed to create a really powerful, for a lot of people, mood, in a sense. And I actually think it's a lot more affective than it is even ideological. So, but then what are the risks of saying we need to kind of, I'm saying we in terms of me here, somebody that would want to be critical about that. What other strategies do you have at your disposal that actually might be more about sense, feeling, and intuition? Or as you say, does that put you in a position where you've got no ground to stand on? And, I think we need both. We need to keep fact-checking.
I suppose one of the people I'm interested in is David Hume, a kind of an Enlightenment thinker. And one of the things that he kind of talks about, I think this, but then I get really hungry and I'm kind of angry and I think that, which is the right way. And his actually argument is that we know the world, and this is kind of like about kind of, we've all been thinking here, haven't we? We've been thinking about feeling. So it's that kind of form of self-reflection that's important, and that allows us to, weigh things up and weigh certain kind of arguments against other arguments. One book I was particularly interested in, I can't remember the title of it, which is about the capitalism before capitalism, which is basically kind of arguing that people started talking about being greedy as having a kind of passion for greed, and that becoming a good thing because it would stop other kinds of moods like wanting to kill people or those sorts of things. So, there is that, we do live in that kind of passionate world. Mm-hmm. Hopefully we also can sit outside it occasionally and think about it and draw conclusions or reflect on it. But I don't think we can do that outside also of other kinds of feelings.
There was one more question here. There's a question there. Let's get the two of them together. So one here and one at the back.
I guess all this presupposes an underlying biochemistry that's going on all the time, and how you feel in yourself health-wise, it has a lot to do with your mood, and some moods you just have to resign to, in the sense that today I do not have the energy, In other words, there's a certain amount of self-knowledge required in order to know where you are and where you're at and so on and so forth, and not to be overtaken by those moods. So this is, which implies a certain detachment, if you like, a development, an inner development of another space that is possible where the meanings of these things are not overwhelming, if you like, whereas they may be initially. There's a maturing to come to terms with things, if you like. Yeah.
Thank you. And the question at the back, that was very helpful, I think.
Hi, thank you for the really interesting discussion. Building on the not just the most recent question, but the one before, I was really interested in the discussion around this link between emotion and rationale. I'm particularly interested in the link towards political economy analysis. And I was wondering what you think comes first in terms of thought and emotion. For instance, something like Brexit or Trump, does that capture the mood of a nation or does it influence the mood of a nation? Thank you.
Easy questions to end with.
Well, thinking about the first one and kind of the biochemistry or just more material, embodied, visceral kind of, yeah, I definitely agree with you. And in my work, and sometimes I think that when we're talking about moods and what mood might be good for this and what mood we should bring to our reading or whatever, I think there's an assumption that we have more choice around mood than we do. And you know, I mean, if you just think of your own personal moods, yes, there's things you can do to cheer yourself up, or but sometimes, as you say, there is nothing you can do, at least for a period of time. And I guess that's part of the reason I'm interested in what might come of inhabiting the mood you're in. Because it might not all be about you either. Like, it's these wider things that are happening. So what do we actually gain through a kind of a different mode of affective attention to kind of the mood that we're in?
I mean, putting those kind of two questions together, I think, you know, because you're saying there's a certain kind of being out of control where you're just subject to your own moods and you're kind of willful, or you haven't had the Mars bar that you needed, so you're kind of really angry. I felt like that about Brexit. Maybe it's because you know, my side lost or something like that. But, you know, I felt suddenly kind of victim to the mood. And I thought, oh, come on, you know, grow up. Don't let yourself be kind of pulled into this mood. But I thought I found it almost impossible not to. I was kind of looking at people and kind of thinking, oh, you know, I've been talking to you every day. But maybe, you know, we're not as we should be.
Yeah, that sounds like a movement towards people. Anil, I'm not going to let you answer that. I'm going to let you pick something to set the mood as we leave the room, because we're going to have to close. You've been a marvellous audience, really amazingly thoughtful questions and an incredible panellist. But why don't you pick something to set the mood for us, to play us out?
I'm looking at this list, realising that they're all sort of really quite sad.
Bohemian Rhapsody.
You want Bohemian Rhapsody? Is this the
Rhapsody?
We actually performed with the choir that I direct. We performed Bohemian Rhapsody with Andy Serkis last week at the Barbican with Brexit themed lyrics. I'd need other singers to do that. I think maybe if we go for, I mean, that's a bit intense. So maybe let's go for number 6, Closer Acoustic.